So this time I have even the pen. Good morning. And the first thing that I would like to discuss with you today is the numerical code that we started discussing yesterday. So let me write explicitly the problem, and after we try to have a look in concrete at the code on Python. So the problem that we're going to discuss is this example 6.8 and after 6.9. And so let's first of all write in concrete what are these two examples. So they are essentially the same example, but we will solve first by using the direct Euler technique and after by using the backward Euler technique. So the problem that you want to solve is the following. So we have rho C du vediamo. Sì, direi di sì. Sto sì. Niente. Ok. Rho C de U over de T minus K second derivative of U respect to X square equal to F of X and T. Okay, this is our equation. And let's concentrate on a specific problem. So this specific problem, okay, you can read the data, is an iron bar. So we have a specific density, specific heat, thermal conductivity. Okay, you can read these numbers from the book, and after I have written explicitly, of course, the same numbers in the code. So for instance, here this is the density, specific heat, and lam, I think that lam is probably the thermal conductivity. Okay, so what else we have to tell? We have to tell this function f, sorry, and the bar has a length of 1 meter. So we are solving between 0 and let's say 100 in centimeters. And this f of x and t is given to be 10 to minus 8 time x 100 minus x squared. And this is in the units, which are watt divided centimeter cube. Okay. And we are solving this problem by imposing the Dirichlet boundary conditions. And also the initial value, so the initial temperature, we just put equal to 0. This is for all x at t equal to 0, while the Dirichlet boundary conditions are the following. Okay, so this is the problem that we want to we want to solve in concrete. And so what we need to do is, first of all, to rewrite the problem in the weak form. Of course, I'm not going to really do, because it's what we did many times the previous lessons. Somewhere, okay, this was the Neumann. Steve, okay, you have on your notes. I must have also here, but let's see. Now for diffusion, this is Neumann. There is no diffusion Fourier, not homogeneous derivative. Okay, somewhere here I must have, but anyway, you recall essentially the type of equation that we are going to obtain is what we obtain if we multiply this equation by a test function, we integrate between 0 and 100, and we perform one partial integration on the term, this term here, which is the term containing the second derivative. Okay, so in that way, we obtain our weak form of a boundary value problem. And in concrete, the next step is to choose a grid, and we are using a uniform grid. We divide the interval between 0 and 100 with a regular partition, equipartition, and we build our triangular functions. There is something that for this very simple problem in which the density and the heat capacity and the heat conductivity, they are all constant, they don't depend on the position or on time, then it is extremely easy to evaluate the matrix elements that we discussed also last time. So for instance, as you recall, we have matrix elements like M and K. Okay, we have two matrices, M and K. And both of them are three diagonal, and the MII, which is defined as an integral between 0 and 100 of the density, but it's a constant, on the specific heat capacity, but it's a constant. And then here we have those functions, phi I, and these functions phi I squared integrated the x. Okay, so since rho c are constant, it is trivial to perform this integral, and you get a number, and the number is twice h rho c divided by 3. What is h? H is the step in X, is the size of one of the partitions, meaning that we have divided our interval, so this is 100, and we have divided in a regular way this interval, and H is this. So if we call, let's say, L, the length, okay, and if we divide in n partitions, then of course we have that h is L divided by n. Okay, and similarly for the other matrix elements. So as I said, M and K, they are three diagonal. So the off diagonal, which is actually is just M I plus or minus one. And Similar is defined as similarly to the previous one. Instead of having phi I, you have phi I plus or minus one, and the calculation is equally simple, and you get h rho c divided by 6. And recall that since we are solving this problem with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, it means that we only need the functions phi I from 1 up to n minus 1. We don't need the phi 0 and we don't need the phi n with the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So this is the matrix M. And similarly, the matrix K is also three diagonal, and KII is the integral between 0 and 100 of K, that is here the thermal conductivity, a constant in this case. And here we have a derivative, d phi I over dx squared, integrated dx, and also this is trivial to compute, and you get twice k over h. And finally, the k I plus or minus 1, which are defined in a similar way, but you have the two indexes shifted by 1. And what you are getting is minus k over h. Okay, so this is the beginning, so to say, of our attempt at solving the problem. We start by writing these matrices, okay, M and K. There is still one ingredient. If we go back to the equation here, so as I said, I mean, we multiply this equation by some test function. The test function are the elements of the basis. So also the right hand side, also F, needs to be multiplied by phi. And therefore we have to perform also an integral, which is an integral, let's call these objects Fi. And they depend on time, actually. And this Fi are the integral between 0 and 100 of the function F of x and t, phi I of x integrated dx. And here on the book, it gives the analytic expression, but instead of writing this analytic expression, which is a little bit lengthy, I decided to evaluate it numerically. So, okay, now let's look in details this numerical code. Okay, so this is our object. Let's see. So we start by telling the number of elements of the grid, I mean, in how many pieces we are portioning the interval 0, 100. So suppose that we take 10. You can of course choose even a significantly larger value, but after the program starts being quite slow.
Sì. Scusi se la interrompo, potrebbe passarci questi codici come certo. Ha fatto anche le scorse okay. Volte, per favore?
Yes.
Grazie.
Yes. This code I really wrote last night. I spent almost the entire night trying to clean up these things. So they are not really written in a most elegant way. And I spent most of the night in trying to find where there was one mistake. That was, of course, the first line where I forgot to change the value of a parameter. It is typical. So what I want to tell is maybe you try to improve these codes, you clean up the codes. As I said, I'm pretty sure it's possible to write them better. So it is Google class, no? Classroom, yeah. Yeah. Uh, dunque. Sempre un altro codice. Questo. Thematical methods. Ok, so you have a 6.1 and 6.3, and now I give you the 6.8 and 6.9. Let me find file, browse. Dunque, documents, lezioni, metodi, and 6.8 and 6.9. Open. Ok, and examples 6.8 and 6.9. Post. Ok, so there we are now. Fine. So you start by choosing n, so how many partitions you want to make of your interval. Of course, the larger n, the larger the number of elements of the basis, so the code will become slower. Okay, these are just the constant, and last night I forgot to change one of these numbers here, and after I was checking everything else, of course I could not find the error because it was at the very beginning of the code. It was, I think, this number here that I wrote it wrong, so I got crazy because of that anyway. And so let's see a moment how to write the two matrices. I did it twice as a sort of exercise. The two matrices M and K are both three diagonal. And what you can do is, if you like, you can check more explicitly the M and K so that they appear as a normal matrix, and you can check that, I mean, you have really filled the right elements. If you want to do that, that actually in the 6.9 it will be important to do, but here instead is just a sort of check. What the way in which you fill a three diagonal matrix I was mentioning already is the following. So essentially you start by building the elements of the diagonals. So you have the main diagonal. I mean, where really you have to be very, 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 very careful is in this n minus 1, n minus 2, and all these things. I try to add comments so that you can understand better what I did. So recall this slightly annoying feature of Python, that the indexes, they always start from zero. So it means that if I want to have a matrix containing n minus one elements, the index actually runs from zero to n minus two. I honestly don't understand why they did it in this way. It seems to me quite confusing, but okay. So here now you have, for instance, this other command that what it does is to produce an empty array containing n minus one elements. Still, recall that they will run from zero up to n minus two. This is the main diagonal. The two other diagonals, they contain one element less, of course. So that's why there is n minus 2. And at that point, in this case, it is quite simple. You just fill, literally, with what we just computed. You recall that for the m, on the main diagonal was this 2h rho c divided by 3, and the off diagonal were these numbers. So at that point, you build your matrix. And if you build your matrix, you, in order to build the matrix in the proper way, you use this little trick, which is this comment, diag, and you tell which diagonal you are speaking about. So, for instance, these two are the two diagonals, not along the main diagonal, what I called off diag, and they are shifted below or above the main diagonal by one unit, where the main diagonal sits exactly there. So you add together and you get your M. And in principle, you can print it and you get your matrix, blah, blah. Exactly the same you can do for K, okay? It's just different values of the elements, but it's exactly the same thing. So we build K, adding together the three diagonals, okay, and you can print in principle. But as you recall, we want to use the fact that the matrices are three diagonal. And to use this feature, it means that we will solve our linear algebra problem not by really computing the inverse of the matrix M and of the matrix K in principle, matrix M in particular, but by using specific techniques which are much faster and that work only if the matrix is a band matrix. So if you want to use one of these codes that after we are going to discuss, you have to write M and K, M in particular, in a special way, which is the one that is requested by that code. So maybe I can run it a second so that we can... only problem is that... Okay, let's do the following because it is not extremely fast. So let's stop it first at... let's stop it at, I don't know, 20. And here we put whatever, we put 40, okay? And I just run the code so that, and we can print some of these things so that we can have a look of what are these objects. Print, and print. Okay, so let's run it. Let's close this so that we don't make it too messy. And let's run it. Okay, so it's producing now also the result, but we can start by looking at this M and K. So this will be the result running up to a certain amount, a certain time. So let's concentrate on M and K for a moment. So M is not extremely easy to read it, but you see that this is the main diagonal. Okay, maybe if I do like this, it slightly improves. So on the main diagonal, there are these 22.9 and blah, blah, here and here and here. And after you have the diagonal above and the diagonal below, okay? And K is similar, main diagonal, blah, blah. Let's have a look now at these numbers here. So what do we expect? You see, this is the way in which that program solving the linear algebra problem, exploiting the fact that the matrix is a band matrix, no? That's how the program wants M to be written. So you have here the upper diagonal written on a row. And you see that since it contains one element less than the main diagonal, I just put a zero, but it's irrelevant. It will never read this number. And I pushed all the other elements to the right. After I have a main diagonal, and similarly for the other diagonal below the main diagonal, I push this time to the left, and I have a zero here. Okay. So similarly for KB. Okay. Fine. So now we have written, if we need, M and MB and K and all that. So what is next? We have to define our piecewise functions. This is what we did already in the past. You recall, you can use this little command piecewise. Essentially what you do at that point is that you introduce conditions. So for instance, you tell that if X is smaller than this, then you get zero. If X satisfies this condition and this other condition, you get this number, and blah, blah, and blah, blah. Essentially, they are triangles, okay? They are triangles centered at the point XI, okay? And the point XI correspond to I times H. So, essentially, we have four conditions. Or we are in the region to the left and or to the right where the function is zero, or really we have a triangle, and the triangle gets on one side this value here, on the other side this other value, and that's it. We have already seen this. Here I introduce a vectorized form of fun. I'm not really sure that after I used it, probably I use it in some intermediate step because I try to check everything. Yeah, I used here. I was really trying to check everything. So I plotted again, for instance, this fan. Okay, but we don't need, okay, so you can even skip that line in principle. This is the right hand side. So on the right hand side, there is the function f of x and t that I brought here. And again, I mean, if you want, you can plot it. To plot it, there is a very important point here that I want to make. Python is definitely not fast, not fast at all. But you can improve quite significantly the speed if you try to avoid having explicit loops. So instead of writing something like compute all the values of fun for x ranging from blah blah and blah blah, that would be extremely slow, you can vectorize this fun. It means that at that point it takes for x and for I as entry of a function, not just numbers, but also arrays. So from what I understand, the reason why after is much faster is that probably it exploits at least in part the parallelization of a microprocessor. I'm not 100% sure of that, if the reason why it's so much faster is because it is partially parallelized, but anyway, it is much faster. So this vectorization that is systematically used as much as possible allows you to deal with objects which are vectors instead of having to deal with each of the component of a vector one by one. Okay. So me too, I had to practice a little in writing every as much as possible as vectors. So it takes a little effort to learn this, but it's worth because you improve significantly the velocity of the code. Okay, this grid here is if we want to plot things, for instance, I want to plot the result or whatever, and on the X with 101 points ranging from 0 to 100. So this grid just contains, if we go here and I type grid, you see, that contains the points on the grid that are used. Notice, these are the points that are just used to plot a function, f of x and t, the result, whatever. I'm not really using 100 points to build those functions, the phi I. I'm only using 10 there. And these are two different grids, if you like. I have a grid on that I used to build the functions, the triangular functions, and I am just using 10 or 20 in the next example of these functions, because instead it becomes too slow. But once I have the functions, okay, are functions, I can plot them anywhere, so no problem in plotting on 101 points like this from 0 to 100. Okay, so that's why I introduced this grid somewhere here, and link space that appears here is exactly doing what you can see. It produces numbers linearly spaced between the first and the second, between 0 and 100, 101 numbers. Okay. Okay, so now let's go to the core of this little program. So you recall that I was mentioning before that in principle, you, in this case, you can compute analytically this integral because f is a simple function. Okay, f of x and t is what I wrote above, is just this object here. So if I multiply this object by the triangular functions, I still get something which is just a polynomial, can be trivially integrated. But in general, instead, it can be complicated or even impossible to integrate analytically. So here I decided to do it numerically. So what I can do is to use this quad. Quad is, I think we met already, is a routine inside this package, scientific Python integrate. You import the specific routine quad here, okay. And okay, you see here is the description of what is quad. But in concrete, the first argument of quad must be the function that you want to integrate. And I mean, the function we want to integrate is a function depending on x, on time, and on I, because it's this object here. We want to integrate this object, depend on x, on time, and on I. But we want to integrate on x. So that the function must be written so that x is the first of the arguments. This is the way in which you tell Python that it has to integrate on x. X has to appear as the first argument. So when I defined fun1, the first argument was x. So if I use now fun1 inside this quad, it knows that it has to integrate on x. And what about the other arguments? They are just parameters. They are just parameters. The time is just the time. And here I again shifted by one that value I. I mean, in this specific case, I could have even skipped doing this. I could have, was not really necessary to shift. But if you recall, a few lessons ago, we discussed a similar case. But I mean, the reason why here I don't really need to put this no, actually it's better if I put also in this case. I was going to tell it's because f does not depend on x, but it does depend on x. So okay. So the reason why I put I plus one is that essentially, if you go back to our triangular functions, okay, these triangular functions, here the first function, the function that is centered on h, corresponds to I equal to 1. If I put I equal to 1, what I read here? I read that for x smaller than 0, I get 0. And after, for x larger than 0 and smaller than h, I get this. And after x between h and twice h, I get this. And x larger than twice h, I get again 0. So, I mean, here I really want to this index I to be linked to the one of the points on the grid that I used in making the partition of the interval. So I would really hate to change again the name there. So x0 is 0, x1 is the first element, which is h, and so on and so forth. So I want to try to stick to that definition, and that is why here I had to shift the argument by one unit, because at the very end, what will happen is that I will have to call this f for a certain argument I, but again, for Python, the I will run from 0 to n minus 2. But here I don't want 0 n minus 2, I want 1 n minus 1. So that is why I had to shift. I know this is tricky. So what I suggest, as I did, is that you try to change. And you see that if you change, you get a disaster, okay? Because you are essentially not choosing the right elements of your basis when you try to reconstruct the solution and whatever. But I think that the only way to try to figure it out is by trying, because of this, I mean, for me at least, I don't know, maybe because I'm very old, I really struggle a lot in recalling which of these objects run from 0 to n minus 2, which one from 1 to n minus 1, etc. So what I do is every time that I introduce a new object, I explicitly check that what I am producing is what I wanted. And at least 50% of the times, I was wrong. Okay, at least. You know that there is a famous anti-correlation. If I was wrong even more than that, it would indicate something special. After, I can tell you, many years ago, you know, in the 60s, when people were speculating about, how was called this, when you communicate with the mind, you know, and they made this test on the Soyuz. If astronauts on the Soyuz were able to figure out what people on the Earth could were thinking. And you can have a positive correlation. So if one of you is thinking black and white, and Okay, if I get more than 50% success, it's a positive correlation and is surprising, but also surprising if you have an anti-correlation. Okay, so if I get systematically less than 50% of the cases, it would be surprising. So I expect that since my answer is almost random, to be roughly 50%. Sorry for this idiocy, but it's true. They did it in the Soyuz. I mean, the Russians have always been very much into, I was called this telepathy, or whatever. Okay. So let's go back to this. Sorry. So my advice here is check and check and check. Every time that you introduce one of these objects, check if the range of the value or values of the indexes that you are introducing is really what you need. Because, as I said, in my case, 50% of the time, I am wrong. Okay, what next? Okay, here I put this note, okay? The note is to recall that try to vectorize as much as possible. Actually, this second part here, I thought that it was possible to do, to vectorize even T, but for the moment I have not really been able to vectorize also in T. I do not exclude that maybe it's possible, but honestly, last night I did not succeed. So I vectorized the dependence on the index I, but not the dependence on the discretized values of time. So anyway, you need to vectorize the object. So the object, this object here is just the projection, if you like, of f of x and t on each of the elements of the basis. Okay, and I vectorized. And here, this other object here is just a vector. This vector, let's plot it, let's print it, vali, is just this. If I have n equal to 10, you recall that I need n functions, meaning that Python will use indexes from 0 to 8. Okay, so this index I here runs from 0 to 8. And this is how I try to speed up things, vectorizing f and the other things, and introducing this value that essentially is the entire range of values of I. And in this way, you see, I can get rid of one of the indexes because I can directly define a new function, f values, that still depend on time, but is an array of values. Okay? If I write, for instance, f values of 3, let's say, what I get is an array. Is because it evaluates for a given time that projection for each of the elements of the basis. Okay. As I said, I do not exclude that if one is smarter than me, it can vectorize even the dependence on T. But yeah, I have not yet been able. Maybe it's possible. I don't know. Okay, so now we go in concrete to our problem. So notice up to now we have essentially prepared all the ingredients. We have written the matrix M and K. We have even written the matrix M in that special form that we know will be used probably later on. We have produced a sort of column depending on time, which is this F and, of T. It is called F values. And what is this all? This is the initial condition. Okay, the initial condition was written somewhere here. Here, okay. The initial condition is that u is equal to zero for all x, okay? So essentially what we are doing is to initialize our problem by putting all the elements of the solution equal to zero at the beginning. That is what I have done here. So 0, 0, 0 at the beginning. So let now discuss a moment how do we write very explicitly this linear algebra problem, because we know in principle, but now we have to be more explicit. That is what follows now. So let me go here and let's concentrate a moment on what really we have. So we have a problem which is of this form. D alpha over dt, D alpha over dt, or better, let's say m times D alpha over dt plus k alpha is equal to f, no? This is our problem. So how do we solve the problem? So we have two steps. The first step, in principle, is to decouple the equations so that we don't have a matrix multiplying the first derivatives, but just a row containing the alpha 1 over the t, the alpha 2 over the t, and so forth. So this is the linear algebra problem, the decoupling. And after, when these equations are decoupled, I can try to solve using one of the most simple techniques, for instance, the direct Euler or the backward Euler. Okay, so these are the two steps that we have to. So, in principle, one could say, oh, it's easy. I just multiply by n minus 1. So if I multiply by n minus 1, what I get is d alpha over dt is equal to m minus 1. Oops, m minus 1. And here I can write, let's say, minus k alpha plus f. Okay. At that point, assuming that I like to do this, that is not what we really like, but assuming that I like to do this, then the solution, if I use the forward Euler, as you recall, is very simple because I discretize in time. I have the initial value, which is the alpha zero that I just introduced, and systematically I proceed in this way. I can write that alpha of I plus one, I mean, this I now is an index of the time, okay? But for each time, alpha is still a vector, okay? Is equal to alpha I vector plus delta t multiplying this line, m minus 1 times minus k alpha. Oops, sorry, this is not a vector, the k, okay, sorry. Tuck, 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 minus k alpha plus f. Okay. So what we have here is a possible solution of our problem. The solution is obtained, as I said, by computing the inverse of the matrix M and after imposing the choosing the direct Euler integration. It's possible to do, okay. I produced in the program both versions, One version uses this technique, but we know that in principle, if we are dealing with a large matrix, it becomes extremely slow, because if we have a large matrix, n by n, we have to compute n minus 1, and even though the original matrix was a band matrix, still n minus 1 is not a band matrix at all, it's different from zero everywhere. So we have to evaluate n squared elements of that matrix. So it becomes rapidly very, very slow, okay? In our case, it's not because n is small, but if in general, it can become very slow. So this is a possibility. And I am going to discuss with you in a moment this possibility. Actually, okay, let's first see also the other possibility. So the other possibility is try not to compute m minus one. And so what does it mean? If I call m minus 1 minus k alpha plus f, let's call this quantity u, okay? And maybe we can even put in principle some indexes, let's say index i, this is for the time, okay? This is for the time, i. So if I look in the line above, no, essentially what this line is telling is you compute ui and you substitute here and you have the problem solved. But there is another way of computing ui. The other way is not really to compute m to minus 1, but to go back in a sense and to say that ui satisfies this equation, satisfies the equation m ui, and u, sorry, is also a vector, eh? If I put an arrow, I have to put an arrow everywhere. Satisfies the equation m ui equal to minus k alpha I plus f I. Well, this seems a little bit silly, because you can say, but you are just going back. Well, in part, in the sense that what I'm now going to say is that if I have this linear algebra problem, and if M is band diagonal, is three diagonal, okay, then there is that routine of Python that allows us to obtain u without computing m minus 1. So in both cases, I want, so to say, to compute u. But in one case, I am really solving, so to say, by computing m minus 1. In the other case, I keep the equation, so to say, as it is written. I pass the information that M is a band matrix, and I let the routine deal with that feature. Okay. So let's go back here. Okay. So I am, in particular, I want to use this solve banded that I think I was mentioning already last time, the time before. Is a routine not inside, notice, not inside NumPy, but inside the scientific Python. Inside scientific Python, there are a lot of packages, and one is this linear algebra that contains a lot of routines for manipulating matrices and solving linear algebra problems. So one of these routines is this solve banded. So we solve banded. So here I wrote the two versions, so to say, of the same problem. So they are very similar, okay? They are very similar, but they are not identical. So what do you do? Okay, so you choose a value of t, and after you will have to systematically increase the value of t, because you go from t0, t0 plus delta t, t0 plus twice delta t, and so on and so forth, till when you arrive to your tf, that is what you want to reach. Okay. So this means essentially that this is where it was really messing things up last night. You have to be consistent. This nth step is what was written here, and so on. So let's go back. If you want to get again the solution, I think that t final, I think it was 160, and nth step was 260. If you want to try to recover the solution of the book. So the final time, no, 180, sorry, 180 was 3 minutes. Final time was 3 minutes, 180 seconds, and the number of steps was, if I recall correctly, was 260, I think. Yeah, 260. So we have to be consistent. So after I put this automatic, I put it here that here t is in range up to nth step plus one. You recall that it is always this little thing that it will stop actually. The last computation will be at nth step, if I write nth step plus one. Okay. How do I update the value of the time, by the way? You see, the time enters, for instance, inside was f values. F values was depending on time, okay, and that's it, because it was not depending on I, because it is an array. So f values just contains the dependence on time, because I am projecting on each of the elements of the basis. So this is the time, and this time I just wrote by saying, okay, you start from zero, let's say, if you like, and you systematically make new steps. The steps are already written here inside this empty step, how many steps, and every step is a step of delta time. Let me tell again. Delta t was written here. So if I have nth step and I know where I want to finish at three minutes, then I have defined the size of a time step. So I am using this information down here, because I tell how many steps the program has to perform in time, and for each of these steps, which is the time, the real time. The real time is the number of the step multiplied by the delta t. I mean, in principle, I had to add t0, but t0 was equal to 0. So in principle, you should write t0 plus delta t times that index t. Is it clear enough what I'm trying to say? Is it okay? Fine. So there are two versions of this little program. So one version is using the normal routine for solving a problem of a form, let's say, AX equal B. Okay, it's called, is inside numerical Python. Is also inside numerical Python, there is also a linear algebra. And what you write here is what is written. What is written here. So you want to solve again this problem, but notice that if I use the simple routine inside numerical Python, what that routine does is essentially really to compute n minus one, because we are not really passing the information that m is three diagonal. So the routine is using some general technique that works for whatever type of matrix. and so it essentially will compute m to minus 1. And this is this command here that now is commented. Or we pass essentially the same information plus the fact that the matrix is banded. So this is what, for instance, we can use. So what I write here is, okay, I have a matrix with one diagonal above, one diagonal below the main diagonal, different from zero. The matrix is called MB, and the problem is MB applied to the unknown equal to the right-hand side. And here I write the right-hand side, okay? And I have to solve this for each of the time steps, because after I have systematically to increase. I mean, I solve, I add the solution for I use that solution here, I get the solution for I plus one, and I repeat in a loop till when I reach the final time. That is what I do with this four. Okay, so, and here I am systematically updating the value of a solution as is written, let's say here. Okay, I mean, if I have been able to obtain the UI, this is UI, I can get the UI by explicitly computing n to minus one. I can get the UI by telling the program this is the equation and then is band matrix, so be smarter. But what I need at the very end are the UI. If I get this UI here, I update alpha by taking the old value plus delta t UI and it's a new value. It is what is written here. The new value is the old value plus delta t times the solution of that thing. Okay, and finally, when you have obtained, you have iterated up to your final time, you can, in principle, look at the solution, and the solution is obtained. These are the coefficients of the expansion of the solution on the basis, and so you use the coefficients to reconstruct the solution. So these are your elements, okay, and you multiply each of the elements of the basis by the last value of these coefficients, the one that you obtain at last, and you sum, so you write that the approximation to the solution is a sum running from 0 up to n minus 2, but we have appropriately shifted these objects here so that the functions will really be 1 n minus 1, okay, because instead we run into some trouble, okay, multiply by the coefficients. In the coefficients, this index I is running from 0 to n minus 2. I know it's very, very annoying, at least for me it is very annoying, but that's it. Okay, and you do that, and okay, the program is not ultra fast. You can try to play with it. It's okay if you put, let's say, 10 or even 20. It depends, of course, on your computer. My computer, it takes, I don't know, couple of minutes maybe to get the solution. For 10 and 20 is a little more, is a factor of 2 probably slower, something like that. Okay, so you can try that. Questions for this, because after we see how to use instead the backward Euler technique. Do you have questions concerning the way I wrote this program? Also from home. Stop eating the spaghetti, because I mean, you should follow this fantastic thing about the solution of this equation. Oh, okay. I assume that everything was clear.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. Fine. You know that I can read in your mind using the technique of the Russian of the Soyuz, so be careful. And fine. Okay, so this is how you do if you want to use this direct Euler. The direct Euler, let me recall once more, at the very end is here. Is I solve this equation by writing alpha at the next time is alpha the previous time plus the time step multiplying this quantity on the right hand side. So all of this quantity here is evaluated at the previous time. Okay, so this is simple, but you recall that we discussed, maybe you recall that we discussed the so-called steep differential equations. So those steep differential equations are a type of equations in which you have various components inside your problem that are evolving with a significantly different speed. So there are components that are, for instance, going to zero much faster than other components. And that can constitute a numerical problem, because if you want to compute the solution with a decent precision, in principle you need to follow the evolution of the rapidly changing components, but if you want to see a significant change of the total solution, you need also to evaluate the solution at large times. The problem is actually even worse than that, because as you recall in that little example, if I have equations where one of the two is evolving significantly different respect to the other, it's not just that, okay, don't care too much about what happens to the components that are evolving rapidly. If I think that I can avoid caring, then I run into a big problem, because if you look back to that example, the solution is just exploding. Essentially, if I use the direct Euler technique. So if I have a problem in which I have components rapidly evolving, if I use the direct Euler, not only I risk not to follow the evolution of those components, but actually they are making our attempt to solve the problem completely unstable. I get an exploding solution. So it means in conclusion that if I have a steep set of equations, I have to choose a very short time scale if I want to use the direct Euler, because instead the solution explodes. What about this equation of diffusion? The equation of diffusion is steep. Why the equation of diffusion is steep? Because we have discussed what happens when solving the problem with the Fourier. Fourier is here. Let's see if we are lucky. And we can even see it. In principle, it should, but life is always. Oh, it's here. Okay. Oh, gosh. In principle, is here. Because it's not Fourier. It's not just Fourier, it's much more than Fourier. And after Fourier is. Maybe it's about. Okay, maybe it's here. sorry, just a second. I wanted to show you something that probably you even recall, but no, because this is, I don't know why I called it Fourier, because this is already, anyway, what you recall, maybe, okay, what you recall, maybe, is that when I solve the equation of diffusion using the time-dependent equation of diffusion using Fourier, what happens essentially is that my coefficients, the Fourier coefficients, evolve in time in a way which is of a form exponential of minus time, and here I have typically the eigenvalues, so I have something as n squared pi squared divided by l squared, etc. So this is the way in which the coefficient of Fourier evolve with time. Okay, you get this exponential, and the very important point is that is an exponential of minus time multiplying lambda n. So why this is important? Because it means that if I go from n equal to 1 or to 2 to 3, etc., the coefficients with relatively large n are going to 0 much faster than the coefficients with n equal to 1. So increasing n, the time evolution towards 0 of the coefficients becomes faster and faster. And we discussed this also by telling that due to this, we lose information in the sense that we can start from an initial distribution of the temperature, which could be very irregular. So I need a lot of terms in my expansion on the Fourier basis to describe it accurately. But after, even after a short amount of time, what happens is that all the components with relatively large n are suppressed, and so I get a smooth solution. So what does this mean if now we try to solve this problem numerically? The problem is stiff. So it means in concrete that I cannot take too large a time step. So this is also something that you can check. You can take this little program and run it by changing the time step, meaning that you can take the same time final, but instead of having 260 steps, you have just, I don't know, 100 or whatever. And you can see if the program is providing a solution which is converging, or if a solution for too large a time step is just exploding. Okay. So to solve the problems which are steep, as you recall, one can use the backward technique, backward Euler technique. And so let's now discuss this backward Euler technique in connection with this problem. By the way, I was mentioning that you cannot take a too large time step. Actually, there is another limit which is important to mention. The other limit is essentially the following. So you have, so to say, the time step delta t, and you have h, which is the step in x on the grid. And what you can check is that you don't get a convergent solution unless delta t is chosen so that it scales with h squared, meaning that if I reduce h by a factor of 2, I have to reduce delta t by a factor of 4. Why is that? If I reduce h, it means essentially that I am investigating more precisely the details of the solution. Is, so to say, equivalent to introducing in a Fourier analysis components with a larger n. But then, if I have these components with a larger n, the system becomes more and more unstable in the time evolution, for the reason that I was mentioning, because you have more and more components which are going to zero very fast, and therefore your system becomes numerically unstable. To try to keep the balance, you need to reduce delta t quadratically with h. So this means that, of course, if I want to have a decent resolution, I need to take a very small delta t. Okay. So let's now go back to the question backward solution. So the backward solution, let me just remind you this, is the following. If we have, let's say, the y over the x equal to f of x and y, okay. So essentially what we try to write is something like this. I mean, we can write that y of x plus delta x is equal to y of x plus the integral between x and x plus delta x dx of f of x and y. Okay. Now, the two techniques, the direct and the backward Euler, corresponds to what we do with this integral. So in the direct Euler, for this integral here, we just write delta x times f of x and y of x. Okay. So we evaluate f at the lower limit of the integral. This is the direct. While instead, in the backward, this integral we evaluate as delta x times f of x plus delta x y of x plus delta x. So, as you recall, the problem here is that we end up with a problem that in general is quite complicated, because the equation using this backward becomes y of x plus delta x equal y of x plus this object here. And so what we want to determine, which is y of x plus delta x, appears both on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side. Of course, the problem is simple or difficult depending on f. If, for instance, f is linear, the problem is very simple. We can use the backward Euler technique essentially in a similar way to the direct technique, because we can easily isolate y of x plus delta x. So in our specific case, the problem is simple, because what we have here on the right-hand side is linear. So in conclusion, with this backward technique, what we get is the following. We get alpha I plus 1, so this is the equivalent of evaluating the solution at the next step, is equal to alpha I, and this is similar to what we So we write alpha plus delta t, okay, plus delta t, and here, okay, it's just the same, sorry, okay, I'm just rewriting the same as before, but, okay, it was minus k, but here this time I have alpha I plus one, so you see I am evaluating this object, but now at I plus one, and f evaluated also at the time I plus one. Okay. So this is in concrete the rewriting of this backward technique. The solution, which is alpha, these are vectors, as you recall. This is a vector, and this is a vector. So the solution at the new time step is the solution at the previous time step. And after I have what is written above, is delta t, but I have to evaluate my right-hand side of equation. I have to evaluate it at the time I plus one, okay? So as usual, what I am not going to do is to really compute n minus one. So I can call all this quantity, whatever, I can call this quantity u just to provide a name. Let's call this quantity u I plus one. But the crucial point is that this quantity u satisfies an equation. And I can multiply everything by m, and I get m alpha I plus one equal to m alpha I plus delta t, and here I just get minus k alpha I plus one plus f of the time I plus one. So you see, that this is why the Euler can be applied in this case, because what I want to determine is this quantity that appears here and here. So I just need to bring this quantity from the right hand side to the left hand side. And so I get essentially m plus delta t k. All this applied to alpha I plus one, and this is equal to m alpha I plus delta t f at the time I plus one. Okay, so this is what we are going to do. We are going to solve this problem exactly. Let's compare with what we did before. I could have written on the same page. Before, we were solving this problem here. We were solving this problem, but in concrete, we were not computing n to minus one. We were instead going back to multiplying by m to this problem and solving this problem for ui. Okay. And now the difference, and this is the direct Euler. The difference is that now I have a similar problem, but I moved something on the left hand side, because I had on the right-hand side, I had the alpha I plus one, and Since the problem is fortunately linear, I can take this and I move on the left-hand side. And so this is the new matrix that appears in my solved banded. Instead of having just M, I have M plus delta TK. And this K is not a vector, sorry. This K is not a vector, by the way. Okay. Notice the important point that in the previous case, what was really crucial was that M was three diagonal, because essentially we instead would need to compute M to minus one. Okay. So if M was three diagonal, we were happy. It was, doesn't really matter if K is three diagonal in this case. Okay. But if we go here, K now appears on the left hand side. So of course, if both M and K are three diagonal, this combination is also three diagonal. And so I can use that solve banded routine. Okay. Is it clear enough the differences between the Dirac and the Euler? So the difference is that in the case of the backward, on the right hand side, typically I have the solution that I'm trying to get, which is also on the left hand side. So I have to recast the equation. If the right hand side is linear in alpha, in the solution, it is simple, as in this case. I just take what I had here and I move on the left hand side. And now I have just to deal with this matrix instead of this matrix M. Okay, so this is what I did in this other example. And it is essentially all the same as before. But if you go down here, this is what I did. I mean, I have to compute the matrix appearing on the left-hand side. So the matrix is this matrix here. Okay. Therefore, it's not just M, but is M plus delta TK. Notice that I want to use that solve banded. So this M back and backward must also be banded. And it's true because MB is the banded version of M and KB is the banded version of K. I mean, M and K are banded, and this is the way in which I rewrite the two matrices, moving the diagonal to rows so that the program solve banded out after I can recognize the structure. Okay. So the important point is that if I want to use the backward Euler, both M and K must be three diagonal, okay, which is the case. And after essentially is identical because at that point what I have to do is to call the solve banded for this M backward, which I define it here. And this is the right hand side as was written here, so is M alpha. Notice that F is evaluated at the time I plus one, okay? It doesn't cause any problem because F is known. So I can evaluate F at the time that I prefer. But I did it here, you see. F values is not evaluated at T times delta T, but at T plus one times delta T, so it's the next step. And that's it. So at that point you have solved, you knew alpha, you started with zero. You compute the new value of alpha that I called al prime, is written here. And now I just tell that the old value of alpha is this al prime. Okay, so that at the next iteration, al will be the previous value, I compute the new one, and so on and so forth. I systematically, at the end of one of these cycles, I just call the old alpha, al, and I use for that the number that I just computed, and I continue evaluating. And if you run it, what you can check is that it is stable, even if you take a significantly larger delta t. For instance, here, I did take 90 steps to arrive at 3 minutes. And if I try to do the same with the other code, it's just exploding. But here it remains stable. And therefore, before we needed 260 steps, there is just 90, so it's almost a factor of 3 in speed using the backward. So that means that if I want, I can spend that time by increasing n, meaning that I am increasing the space resolution. Okay, so what I suggest is that you play with this code. As I said, it is possible that you can even improve them. And in any case, try to check what happens by changing the time steps and all that. Okay. Because there are a lot of tiny details that if you want to learn how to write these things, you have to work out by yourself, by running the code and trying to make some little change at least. Okay. If you don't have questions, I can spend the last half an hour telling you about Neumann boundary conditions. You have questions concerning what we have done? No questions. Okay. Fine. So, if there are no questions, let us discuss at least this thing here. So, what we have done, okay. I mean, we are still discussing our diffusion equation. We have discussed the diffusion equation using the Fourier technique, and we have discussed what was happening with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, the Neumann boundary conditions using Fourier. And now we want we have done the Dirichlet boundary conditions for the finite elements, and we want to discuss the Neumann boundary conditions with the finite elements. Okay. So, okay, let another page, let's call this diffusion with Neumann. Okay. Fine. So, what I want to revisit with you is something that we started discussing, we discussed in part already. So, essentially, this problem of the Neumann boundary conditions. And there is something a little bit special concerning the Neumann boundary conditions. And to understand to understand what is special, let's start by considering the time-independent problem. Okay, so let's discuss the following problem: minus derivative respect to x of k of x du over dx equal to f of x, and Neumann boundary conditions, du over dx evaluated at zero is zero, as well as du over dx, which x equal to L. Now, if you recall what we did in the case of the Dirichlet boundary conditions, you recall that we were considering a space in which the solution and the test functions, they were satisfying the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So you recall that in the case of Dirichlet, we were considering a space, let's call the space, I don't know, L square D in the interval whatever, 0L. And this L square D was such that U of 0 equal to U of L equal to 0. And also for the test function, it was V of 0 equal to V of L equal to 0. So what happens here is that instead, when I go to the weak form of this boundary value problem with the Neumann boundary conditions, funny enough, I don't need to tell anything concerning the behavior of the test function and of the solution at the boundaries. Now, this looks a little bit bizarre, and let's see what I mean for real. So what we are going to do is to show, first of all, that, as usual, that there is an equivalence between the strong version and the weak version. And in particular, we start by assuming that the strong version is solved, okay? And we will show that the weak version form is satisfied, but we don't need to impose any boundary condition on the test function. So this is the first step. First step is I assume that I have solved the strong version problem, and I want to show you that the weak version of a problem is satisfied, but I had not to impose any constraint on V concerning the boundary conditions. So let's see how this happens. So suppose that we have solved this problem, so that this is satisfied. And therefore, as I said, let's assume that our test function is generic. Okay, generic meaning that it belongs, let's say, to a space like this one, but without boundary conditions. Okay, we don't impose anything on the test function, only to belong to, let's say, the same L square or C2, whatever. Okay, so now we start from this strong version, and as usual, we multiply by the test function and we integrate. So it means that we get something as minus integral between 0 and L, dx, derivative respect to x of k of x, du over dx, the test function, v of x, and this is equal to the integral between 0 and L dx of f of x v of x. Okay, v of x. So now, as usual, perform a partial integration, and on the right hand side, and therefore what we get is minus k the u over the x v of x evaluated between 0 and L plus the integral between 0 and L dx of k of x du over dx dv over dx. So I just rewritten the left hand side in this way. Okay. Now here comes the first point. The first point is that what I'm going to demonstrate is that if the strong version is satisfied, I can rewrite this problem in the weak version without imposing anything on V. And what happens? That you see this first term is equal to zero because the derivative of U vanishes at L and at zero, because I have assumed that I have solved the strong version of the problem. So I am assuming that I have solved a strong version, and I want to check what happens concerning the weak version. So the first term is now zero because the u over the x vanishes at zero and at L. I don't need to tell anything concerning V. So it means, in conclusion, that I get the following statement. I get that, okay, I can rewrite just a second, integral between 0 and L, dx of k of x, du over dx, dv over dx is indeed equal to the integral between 0 and L, dx, f of x, v of x, and I had not to impose on V any boundary condition. So let's call this space, so this is for whatever V belonging to a space that called, as in the book, V tilde. So V tilde is, let's say, for instance, C squared 0L. So is not this is larger than C square Dirichlet 0L or whatever else. Okay, this was a typical space B. Okay, so I can claim that if a strong version is satisfied, then this equation is satisfied for whatever V belonging to this large space. Therefore, I can claim this is the weak version where the test function is a generic function belonging to the space without boundary conditions. Okay, so now I need to show the opposite. I need to show that if the weak version is satisfied, funny enough, the strong version is satisfied, including the boundary conditions on the solution. This is a little bit more surprising. A little bit more surprising. So now assume that what I wrote as last line is true. Assume that this equation is satisfied for whatever V belonging to this V tilde. Okay, so we have essentially to go back to the previous equation. So again, we perform a partial integration And what happens is that we get, so instead of this object here, I integrate on the piece containing the v over the x, and so I get k of x du over the x v evaluated between 0 and L, and minus the integral between 0 and L dx of derivative respect to x of k of x du over dx v of x. And I know that this is equal to the integral between 0 and L dx f of x v of x. And this is true for all v belonging to v tilde. Okay. And v tilde is a space which is larger than v. That would be the space where I have imposed, for instance, let's say, the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So what I'm saying is that this equation here is satisfied for whatever v belonging to v tilde, and therefore is satisfied also for the v belonging to the restricted subspace, that is the one that I called v. The ones where the v functions are vanishing at the two extremes. I mean, let me tell again. This last equation that I wrote is satisfied for whatever v belonging to a large space, therefore is also satisfied for whatever v belonging to the smaller space. But if I restrict myself to the smaller space, what happens is that, therefore, if I take v belonging to the smaller space v, I can drop, of course, the first term in this equation because v is now vanishing at 0 and at L. So for whatever v belonging to this v, I can tell that I get the equation minus integral between 0 and L dx of k of x du over dx v of x is equal to the integral between 0 and L dx f of x v of x. And this is true for whatever v belonging to this subspace. Recall that this v is the v containing the Dirichlet boundary conditions. Okay. So what... Sorry? Dove? Grazie, sorry, I forgot a derivative, sorry, I forgot a derivative, sorry. Yeah, thanks. Okay, so this is true for whatever v that is vanishing at the border. So using the usual trick, one can choose v functions which are localized, so that essentially they are different from zero, let's say, only in a certain relatively small region. What does this mean? That since the v are arbitrary, okay, they are vanishing at the border, but for that they are arbitrary, it means that the equation without the v, so to say, needs to be satisfied. It means that minus, maybe it's clearer if I rewrite together, let's say, if I put the two pieces together, I mean, it's quite trivial, but I can write this integral between 0 and L, the x of, let's say, I put just the two pieces together. So the first piece is a derivative over x of k of x du over the x, and the second is f of x, v of x, and this has to be equal to zero. Okay, so this needs to be satisfied for whatever we satisfy the Dirichlet boundary conditions. Okay, but then this means in concrete that for whatever x strictly inside the interval 0L, what is in the curl bracket must be zero. Okay, so what is in the curl bracket was the equation in the strong version. What remains to be demonstrated is that, funny enough, also the boundary conditions of the strong version are satisfied. So what we have demonstrated is, for a moment, is if I claim that I have satisfied the weak version of the problem, then I can show that concerning the strong version of the problem, okay, the differential equation is satisfied. Still, I need to check that the solution of the equation satisfies the two Neumann boundary conditions. That is what we are going to do now. Okay, is it clear enough up to now? Okay, fine. So let's see how to check that. So if we go back, if we go back to this equation here, okay. So this is the rewriting of the strong boundary value problem, and just a second, because I got really confused now. Okay, so we want to check now that the solution of the equation, satisfies the fact that the u over the x is also zero at zero and at L. So what we have already checked is that for all the x strictly belonging inside the interval 0L, we have that this quantity here is equal to zero, the derivative respect to x of k of x, the u over the x plus f of x is equal to zero. So if we go back here, if we go back to this form here, okay, this means that this equation here and this equation here, they cancel one with the other. So what remains to understand is, it is true or false that this is equal to zero? Let me tell it better. The strong version of the problem, that is written, we wrote at the beginning here, the strong version of the problem, we just by multiplying by the test function and performing an integration, was leading us to this equation here. Now, what we know is that for whatever test function, this quantity here is equal to this quantity here, is what we have demonstrated a moment ago. We have demonstrated that the differential equation by itself is satisfied. So if we go back here, it means essentially that these two terms are canceling one against the other. So in order to show that the strong version is satisfied, including the boundary conditions, we have to understand better what does it mean that this quantity here is equal to zero. So what we are getting is that k of x du over dx v of x, and this evaluated between 0 and L is equal to 0, and this is true for whatever v belonging to the v tilde. Okay, so we know that this is true. Does this tell us anything concerning the u over the x evaluated at zero and evaluated at L? Well, yes, because again, we can choose the fact that this is true for whatever v belonging to this large space. You recall that v tilde is the space that does not incorporate boundary conditions. So if I choose, for instance, a test function, let's say v of x equal to, let's say 1 minus x divided by L, so essentially it is v of 0 equal to 1 and v of L is equal to 0, this belongs, of course, this object here belongs to the v tilde, okay? And so I know that this equation here is satisfied also for this v of x. But this means in concrete that I get k of 0 du over dx evaluated at 0 equal to 0, because the v at 0 is 1. And the k is an object that we have always chosen to be strictly positive, and therefore this implies that du over dx evaluated at x equal to 0 is equal to 0. And similarly, if I use as a test function v of x equal, let's say, x over L, then v of 0 is equal to 0 and v of L is equal to 1, and therefore when I substitute inside this condition here, this transform into telling that k of L du over the x evaluated at L is equal to 0, because it at the origin it is v that is equal to 0, and at L v is just 1, so we just get this. And again, k of L is always different from 0, and therefore I get du over dx evaluated at L is equal to 0. So this, what we have demonstrated, is somehow slightly surprising, in the sense that we have demonstrated that the strong version of the boundary value problem with Neumann boundary conditions, so it's a problem where I make a request concerning the derivative of the function at the two extremes, can be rephrased as this problem here, where I do not put any constraint on v tilde. And because of that, then the solution u automatically satisfies the Neumann boundary conditions. Okay? You can, so to say, figure it out maybe in this way. Since I am imposing this equation on a larger space than the Dirichlet, including objects which are not vanishing at the two boundaries, it is a stronger constraint that I am now imposing. this equation need to be satisfied also for V functions which are not vanishing. Because of that, the U function automatically has to satisfy some constraint at the two extremes. Which constraint? It turns out that are exactly the Neumann constraints. Okay. In the other case, since the test function instead was limited to be zero at the two extremes, the solution needed also to be limited at the two extremes. So it was working with U and V belonging to the restricted space. Here, if I use a test function which is not limited to the restricted space, I automatically get a solution which satisfies the Neumann boundary conditions. Okay, you have questions? Okay, so next lesson we finish completely diffusion, and after we start discussing oscillations. And okay, what I advise is that you play a little with Swiss numerical codes, because I mean, the tricky part I think are the indexes. Is a little bit confusing sometimes, so and you can of course easily check some of the statements that I was making about how small delta t has to be, not to be, in order to avoid divergence of the solution, etc. And yeah, I would be curious to see if it is possible to vectorize completely the problem, meaning that instead of having a loop, which is the loop on time that I have at the end somewhere here, I have this four, and I wonder if one can skip that, if one can, maybe not, because the point would be that avoiding a loop, the program could in principle run even faster, but maybe it's not possible. It's just, we're just speculating about that. I've not been able, so maybe it's not possible. Okay, good. Fine, have a nice end of the week.
Grazie mille, altrettanto.
Ciao, ciao.
Arrivederci.
Arrivederci.
Allora, stop sharing. And stop recording.